हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू आवर प्रोग्राम एंटाइटल्ड कंसिडरेशंस फॉर करिकुलम प्लानिंग। नाउ बिफोर वी इनिशिएट आवर डिस्कशंस ऑन दिस पर्टिकुलर टॉपिक दैट इज कंसिडरेशंस फॉर करिकुलम प्लानिंग, लेट अस फर्स्ट गेट एन ओवरव्यू ऑफ द सब टॉपिक्स और द एस्पेक्ट्स दैट वुड बी टेकन अप फॉर डिस्कशन ड्यूरिंग दिस पर्टिकुलर सेशन। सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वी शैल डिस्कस द टर्म करिकुलम। What curriculum means, the definitions, some of the definitions of course, nature, scope, meaning, etc. about curriculum. But while discussing today's topic, it is presumed that you already have learned what curriculum means. You already know what curriculum is. You are aware of the definition of curriculum, you are aware of its meaning, but nevertheless, we shall take up a brief description or brief discussion rather on this particular subtopic so as to refresh our knowledge, our learning about curriculum, because today's topic is based on this subtopic, that is curriculum. Following that, we shall take up again a brief description of the basis of curriculum. Let me tell you that while you had been studying the topic curriculum, you must have also studied about the basis of curriculum, but the basis of curriculum are very much related, intimately related to the considerations for curriculum planning, and they are related to such an extent that we could say that these two aspects are interwoven with each other. Therefore, we shall have a brief overview of this subtopic, that is the basis of curriculum. And thereafter, we shall switch over to today's topic, that is primary considerations for planning the curriculum. This would be followed by a discussion on the models of curriculum planning. Now, let me tell you in this respect that there are several models of curriculum planning, but we shall limit our discussion to some of the major ones. And after that, the agencies that are involved in curriculum planning, that is, who plans the curriculum? Can a layman do it, or does it need any sort of expertise and above all the authority to do so? So which are the agencies that does the curriculum planning? And after that, we shall wrap up our discussion by presenting an illustration on the recently prepared National Curriculum Framework by NCERT. So let us start the discussion. First of all, as I just mentioned, we shall try to refresh our earlier learning about curriculum. What does the term curriculum mean? Well, as we know, as we have already studied, that curriculum means the sum total of experiences, which could be academic in nature or non-academic in nature, that have been deliberately designed and planned. So friends, we see that in this particular definition, there are two parts. While the first part says that curriculum is constituted by the sum total of experiences that are provided at educational institutions, and these experiences could be academic in nature and also non-academic in nature. Now, what are academic experiences? Well, all the activities like reading, writing, listening to the lectures of the teachers, participating in them, being interactive in the classroom while the lectures are being delivered, or watching the teacher demonstrate an experiment, perform experiments in the laboratory, doing some project work, completing the assignments, going on field trips. So these are some of the important academic activities. Now, apart from these activities, other activities are definitely taken up in educational institutions. Now, these activities are although not of academic nature, but nevertheless are very important for imparting education in a holistic manner. For instance, the co-curricular activities. We know that the importance of co-curricular activities cannot be undermined. Then work experience, the work that is taken up for the community. And so many other activities are there that are non-academic in nature. So, all these experiences together with the academic activities, the non-academic activities together, they comprise the curriculum. Now, this is the first part of the definition. The second part of the definition, what does it say? It says deliberately designed and planned. So, we see that these learning experiences or the teaching learning activities in educational institutions are not picked up at the whims of the teachers or the school authorities. They are not picked up at random. They are well planned and the planning is done much in advance. So, we see that these experiences are included not by chance but deliberately. So, we see that the sum total of experiences which have been planned, designed well in advance. These things make up the curriculum. Now, what is the basis for selecting certain learning experiences over others? You could ask that why include a particular learning experience and not some other? Well, the answer would be that we have certain goals and objectives. We shall discuss about this in details later on during this discussion. For instance, educational goals are there, and then again objectives are framed by the teachers. Goals, as we know, are long term while objectives are short term. The goals of education, what are they? For instance, to enhance productivity. This could be one of the goals of education. And then again, to develop feelings of secularism, unity, cohesion. And now that we plan to develop our society into a knowledge society, we need learners who would be lifelong learners. So the curriculum has to be such that the learning experiences, rather, to be more specific, have to be selected, have to be designed in such a manner that the learners are capable of independent learning even after they come out of the educational institution throughout their life. And then we say that today's society is very much dependent on information. And as a result, we need learners who would be able to access information using the tools of ICT and use it as tools for learning. So we see that these are some of the goals of education. And then again, the teacher could have short-term objectives. For instance, the students would be able to develop certain skills, computing skills or linguistic skills. So these goals, objectives give a direction to the experiences that are selected and put forth in the form of a curriculum. Now we see that these planned learning experiences that are provided through an educational program are basically meant to achieve certain goals and objectives. So, we could say that the formulation and implementation of an educational proposal, which is to be taught and learned at the educational institution by providing certain learning experiences for which the educational institution accepts responsibility at three levels. Now, what are these three levels? First of all, the rationale. Why these experiences are being provided. Then the implementation. The curriculum that has been framed for that particular educational institution, whether it is being implemented in true sense, in a meaningful way, in the true spirit, or if some part goes unimplemented, or if there is any distortion. So, this is the second responsibility of the educational institution. The third, for which the educational institution stands responsible, is pertaining to the effects of imparting the learning experiences as selected. So, we see the effects on whom? The effects on the behavior of the learner, the learning outcome. What is the result of implementing the curriculum? What are the gains that have been made by the learner? So, these are some of the effects. What changes are there in the behavior of the learners following the experiences that have been provided to them. So we see that educational institutions cannot absolve themselves of the responsibility of implementing, accepting and implementing a particular curriculum. We could have a summary of what we just have been discussing regarding curriculum, that it is deliberately designed and planned and organized also in a particular way. It is not that the experiences that are selected could be presented in any haphazard way. No, it's not like that. A certain amount of planning also goes into the sequencing of the learning experiences, that is, which is to be provided first and it is to be succeeded by what, or in between should there be any other experience. So we see that regarding organization also there is some planning, and as we have been discussing, the entire activity is goal oriented. So we see, now I think we understand the difference between curriculum and syllabus. What is the difference? What is the basic difference? The basic difference is that curriculum is a much broader concept. It is a much wider concept, while syllabus pertains mainly to the textbooks and also the other activities that are very much related to the textbooks. So we see that the curriculum could include co-curricular activities, field trips, work experience, social work, while the textbook is just a part of the curriculum. In that, it helps in implementing the curriculum. So we could say that a curriculum has two parts: the core, which has to be followed by the educational institutions, and it mainly comprises elements like science, social science, math, languages at the school level, and apart from that there is a periphery of this curriculum. Now, while the core has got an element of rigidity about it, regarding the periphery there is more flexibility, and the teacher, the educational institution, they can make certain changes in the peripheral components. So what is the need for these peripheral components of the curriculum? We see that our country is rich in its diversity. So as to cater to the local needs, the diverse needs of the populations residing in different areas, different states of the country, we have this peripheral component of the curriculum. So we see that textbooks have got a more prescriptive nature, whereas the curriculum is literally a broad framework. Now coming to the basis of curriculum. What are the basis of curriculum? We have already said that we presume that you already have studied about the basis of curriculum. Therefore, we shall not go into the details. First of all, the social forces. What are the social forces? First of all, as we have been discussing, the goals of education that have been set up by the society. Now we know that educational institutions are set up by the society for providing education to its members. So educational organizations are invariably social in nature. Therefore, they cannot overlook the social obligations, the goals that have been set up by the society to be achieved through education. So we see that there are certain goals. We have discussed about them. For instance, enhancing productivity, developing learners into lifelong learners, developing certain values, attitudes, etc. Then the cultural heritage. Now, what has education got to do with cultural heritage? We see that education is a powerful means of preserving and transmitting the cultural heritage that is there. So we see that through education, the cultural heritage, the traditions, these things have to be kept alive and passed on from one generation to another. So the curriculum should reflect this. The curriculum should include learning experiences that provide the learners with the knowledge of the culture of the society. Then apart from that, the history. Now, for instance, it is being said that the freedom struggle, the independence movement, about this, the coming generations should be aware about the colonial past and also the freedom struggle that was undertaken to secure independence. So this is also an important part which needs to be reflected in the curriculum. And then of course the policies and plans of the government. We know that in our country we have 5-year plans and education finds a prominent place in it. So what are the plans regarding education? In keeping with this, the curriculum is framed. And then again the policies. For instance, the National Policy on Education that was framed in 1986, it requires students at school level to have the knowledge of 3 languages. So we have this 3-language policy. And then again we now have policies that at school level itself, computer literacy should be developed among learners. So these policies to find a reflection in the learning experiences that comprise the curriculum. The next important point is the nature of learners. We see that the learner is one of the most important factors while planning a curriculum. So the age of the learner, of what age is the learner? Because mainly on the age depends the maturity. Maturity is more or less related to the age, and of course environmental factors and other factors are also there, but it is basically pertaining to the age. And on maturity depends the readiness to learn, readiness to acquire certain experiences. So we see that age factor is very important. Whether the learner is in the 5th grade or in the 4th grade or in the 12th grade or in the college level, in which year? So these things determine the curriculum. Then the previous experiences. What has the learner learned earlier? For instance, while developing the curriculum for upper primary level, say for class 7 or 8, we take into consideration the learning that has taken place at the lower primary level, the skills, the knowledge with which the learner enters the upper primary level or the next level for which the curriculum is being prepared are very important. So we see that the previous experiences, they have to be taken into consideration. Then of course the interest of the learners. What interests them? Today's learners, influenced by the society, the media, what is of interest to them? For instance, a child who is in the 1st or 2nd grade, while teaching the child to add or to subtract, we could use experiences that talk about balloons, chocolates, toys. Why? Because these are the things that are of interest to the learners of this particular age. Whereas these examples could be meaningless to a learner who is in the 9th grade or in the 10th grade. So we see that the interests of the learners are very important. Then their needs. We know that the needs of learners are not static. They are dynamic and are very much influenced by the social, or rather the socio-economic forces. So what would be the requirements as far as their employment or future education are concerned? So keeping in view these aspects like future employment or education, the needs regarding that have to be kept in view while framing the curriculum for the learners of today. So we see that the nature of learners happens to be an important base of curriculum. Then the principles of learning. For instance, learning can take place only when there is some previous understanding regarding a particular topic or in a particular area. That is the previous knowledge about which we have just discussed. Then comes sequencing. It goes without saying that the learning experiences have to be provided from a simple to complex manner. And this is perhaps the reason why children are taught first to add, then to subtract, and thereafter to multiply and divide. The easiest thing is taught first, and basing on that, more complicated things are taken up later on. So we see that the sequencing has to be logical. So the sequencing or the organization of the learning experiences is also very important. It is not enough to select some experiences over others. It is equally important to organize them. And then learning is always effective if the experiences are related to the daily life of the learners. About the daily experiences of the learners. For instance, a learner would know that in the kitchen while someone is preparing a chapati, that it swells up. This could be a common experience. And then again, before rain, there is a thunder or lightning. So these are some of the daily experiences of children or of the learners. So the learning experiences have to be related to their daily life, their interest, and then the nature of knowledge. We know that knowledge is not static in nature, but that it is dynamic. It keeps on changing, and one has to cope up with the phenomenon of exploring knowledge on one hand and the obsolescence of knowledge or of information or of technology on the other. So we see that we have to deal with these twin problems, and knowledge therefore needs to be updated. So the learning experiences that were relevant years ago may not be relevant now. So depending upon the present knowledge, the present information, the current information rather, the experiences have to be selected. Then coming to another important aspect, that is the institutional resources. What are institutional resources? For instance, the human resource of the educational institution, that is mainly the teachers. Whether the teachers themselves are competent to impart certain kind of experiences. For instance, if developing computer literacy is a must, then it has to be ensured that the educational institution is endowed with teachers who themselves are computer literate, or there are some teachers who can carry out this exercise in a competent manner. So we see, and apart from that, the laboratories, how well equipped they are, whether there are ICT facilities. So while developing or planning a curriculum, the resources of an average educational institution has to be taken into consideration. The planning cannot be only for the elite educational institutions, but also those that cater to the masses are to be considered. So we see that institutional resources are there, and then again the time available. For instance, in our country, the grades have got one academic year, that is 1 year, and from that also we have to keep aside the vacations and other holidays. So in reality, what is the time that is available with the teacher and with the learners? For instance, in order to cope up with knowledge explosion, if we try to overburden the teachers and learners with a lot many experiences, maybe the time would not permit for their effective transaction. So we see that this time factor also happens to be very important. Now coming to the considerations for planning the curriculum. We have so far gained an idea about what curriculum is, the basis of curriculum, and now what are the primary considerations for planning the curriculum. First of all, there is a necessity to understand the premises. What are the premises? First of all, the educational purposes, and as we have been discussing, the long-term goals that are to be achieved in terms of knowledge, skills, attitudes, and also the short-term objectives are there that are framed by the teachers. So why are these educational purposes so important? Because they provide a direction. They provide the teachers and the learners and even the school management or the management of any educational institution with the direction of what is to be taught and learned. Otherwise, the teachers would find it difficult to select the learning experiences, what to teach, what is to be learned, and also specifications regarding co-curricular activities, as we have already discussed, academic activities as well as non-academic activities, and then what to evaluate, how to evaluate. So we see that educational purposes are very important as one of the premises for planning the curriculum. Then coming to the educational experiences that are needed to attain these purposes. So, for instance, if the aim is to develop learners as computer literate people, then what sort of learning experiences are to be provided to them? So, we see that the educational experiences that are needed to attain the goals that have to be selected after that. And then, as we have been discussing, their organization, that is sequencing, selection of the experiences followed by the sequencing of the experiences. Then coming to another very important part, that is implementation. What are the ground realities at the educational institutions? What sort of educational resources are there? Do they permit the implementation of the curriculum that is being proposed? So these are some of the basic questions. Are there competent people to carry out the implementation? And many other factors are there. So we see that the implementation part also has to be taken into consideration. And finally, evaluation. Now, this evaluation is very important because it throws light on the implementation part and to ensure or to rather check whether the educational purposes have been achieved or not, whether the teaching method was appropriate, and before that whether the learning experience selected was appropriate, whether the style of learning was satisfactory, whether the time devoted was enough. So many factors are there. So we see that evaluation is essential as a part of curriculum planning. Now coming to certain continuation of the primary considerations, the nature of discipline. We see that disciplines have got their own unique needs, their unique requirements. Some might require practical work on a large scale, and some may not require practical activities. Some could require outdoor activities, while some may not. So we see that the nature of discipline happens to be very important. For instance, for science, for disciplines pertaining to science, it is also important to chalk out the practical activities besides the theoretical ones. Then coming to the learner, we have already discussed the need, maturity, interests. These are some of the factors that have to be taken into consideration. Then the society. This also we have discussed. The culture, the needs, and also the legal aspects. The curriculum framed should not include any experience that violates the law of the land. So we see that the legalities, the rules, regulations of the society should not be violated while implementing the curriculum. So this is also very important. Then the philosophy of the society. For instance, in our society, the basic philosophy is that we need to develop people with secular outlook who would build up unity, cohesion, and then the economic conditions. We have already discussed it, whether the economic conditions because of which the educational institutions could be endowed with certain facilities or could be deprived of them. So this also goes into the planning of the curriculum. And then the institutional considerations we have discussed, and then coming to the current trends. While planning a curriculum, the current trends have to be kept in mind. For instance, globalization. Now we know that with globalization, there is free flow across borders of nation states, of manpower, finances, trade, and we are moving from closeted societies to more open ones. So the learners should be prepared to work in other societies. Hence, the education imparted, while on one hand should cater to the cultural needs of the society, on the other hand should prepare learners for a global society. Therefore, there should be a wider perspective of the curriculum. Then an interdisciplinary approach. This is also very important. What is an interdisciplinary approach? Through this approach, there is an attempt to link various disciplines. This type of linking, why is it necessary? As it helps in understanding the facts in a better manner, in associative learning. For instance, let me give you an example in this regard. A chapter or a topic on water in chemistry. Now, the chapter could explain to the learners the physical properties of water, the chemical properties of water, and at the same time make them aware about the importance of saving water, of conserving water, the sources that pollute water, that is the sources of pollutants, water pollutants, and how to avoid that, what are the hazards of wasting water. So we see that chemistry and environmental science are being interlinked. And then again, for instance, a chapter in English which tries to build up the vocabulary of the students, tries to make them aware of new phrases, idioms, could be based on the life and work of a mathematician or of a scientist. So we see that these disciplines are getting interrelated. And apart from that, we have been discussing that there are certain principles of learning which cannot be violated, and therefore there has to be a psychological approach that is proceeding from simple to complex, keeping in view the readiness of the learners, etc. And now, as the trend is for using ICT, the learners must not only be able to use ICT, but they should also be able to use ICT for learning, as a tool for learning. And the curriculum needs to provide experiences which will help them in this direction. Then it has to be learner-centered, that is, we have to take a constructivist view. Why? Because as we know that learning by doing is the best way of learning. And as a result, we have today textbooks with number of activities that can be performed by the students with the help of the teachers. Why? To promote learning by doing. Now, in this regard, we could say that a curriculum is an educational proposal that articulates about the learning experiences, and it has to address certain basic questions. First of all, what are the educational purposes or goals? Next, what are the experiences suitable to achieve these goals? Then, how to implement it or how to organize these experiences, and how to evaluate it. Now, coming to, let us have a pictorial description of the primary considerations. Slide, please. So, we see that at the center is the goal. It is of prime importance, and just around that are the learners. And finally, we have the implementation and evaluation part. So, with the help of this pictorial description, we can summarize what we had been discussing so far. Now coming to the models of curriculum designing, we see that there are several models as mentioned in the very beginning, but we shall limit our discussion to only a few major ones. First, with which most of us are aware, is the subject-centered or the discipline-based model. Even in schools, in colleges, we have different subjects or different disciplines, and today the talk is about having an interdisciplinary approach, which we have just discussed. For instance, we have languages, we have math, science, social science. So these are the various disciplines, and the model envisages that the learner would be endowed with the necessary knowledge and the skills pertaining to this particular discipline. And after that, we have the specific competency model. Here, specific competencies are to be built up in certain groups of people. For instance, we might intend to bring about certain behavioral changes, or performance-based objectives could be there for it. For instance, a person who enrolls in a teacher education institution could be provided with learning experiences that would teach the learner with the various skills of teaching. And following the completion of the course, the learner would be endowed with these skills. For instance, how to introduce a lesson, how to use the blackboard, how to put up questions, and there are many other things. And then again, we have several such specific competency based models. For example, medicine, architecture, law. So, at the completion of these particular educational courses or programs, it is expected that there would be some behavioral changes leading to certain specific abilities within the learners. Then certain other models, social functions or activities models. Now, this is based on the premise that education takes place in a social milieu. We know that Dewey had said long back that schools are miniature education societies, and education in exclusion from the social environment is not possible. We also know this. So, we need educational programs that are socially relevant, and not only this, through the educational experiences, the learners should be able to maintain a close relation with the community, with the society. And this is the reason why, let me give you an illustration. For instance, in the teacher education program, there is a component of social work. Community services are there for even school students. So why? This is because it is presumed that education takes place within the immediate social environment. Then coming to the individual needs and interest model, this is the learner-centered model. What the learner wants, the needs of the learners, the interests and capabilities of the learners, these form the primary considerations for framing the curriculum. So we see that this is basically a constructivist view, a constructivist approach, in which what the learner does is of more importance in this particular model. Now that we have been discussing about the models of curriculum planning, let us discuss the agencies that are responsible for it. We know that any layman cannot undertake the task of curriculum planning, and for this special expertise is required, and there are certain agencies that are involved in it. Teachers are there in the school or in the other educational institutions to implement it, to transact the curriculum. But there are academic bodies. For instance, in higher educational institutions, we have board of studies, academic councils, where the teachers prepare the draft of the curriculum and are also active in regulating it. But and apart from that, for higher education, we also have the professional bodies like NCTE. Then of course the UGC is there, ICAR, AICTE. These are some of the professional bodies. For for higher education. But when it comes to school education, it is the NCERT which is primarily having the responsibility of planning and developing the curriculum. Now coming to the role of NCERT, as we know that it is an apex national level body for bringing about educational reforms. At which level? At the school level. So apart from its other functions like providing training, carrying out research, developing the curriculum, reviewing it as a routine matter and reframing it is one of the most important activities carried out by NCERT. And recently in the year 2005, it came up with the National Curriculum Framework. Now this is an illustration to explain the discussion that we have been carrying on till now. So there is an audit of the context. What does it mean? That collection and analysis of all the relevant information to build up an understanding of the current curricular provisions. What are the curricular provisions at present? What learning experiences are being imparted? How they are being implemented? And the areas then have to be chalked out that require improvement, that require innovations. So we see that all the relevant information regarding the present curriculum is to be collected, and after that the review is undertaken. And how is it done? Through collegiate discussions, that is discussing with peers. Then seminars are held, brainstorming sessions are there, researches are undertaken, interviews are conducted, studies are taken up, surveys are there. So these are some of the tools, some of the means for gathering information on the present curriculum and the changes that are needed. And we see that there was a report published by a committee set up by the MHRD in the year 1993 or 1992, and that report was entitled Learning Without Burden. And the curriculum framework that has been developed recently is basically based upon this particular report. And since the implementation of the National Policy on Education in 1986 and the Program of Action to implement it in 1992, NCERT had been urged to develop a curriculum, a curricular framework that would cater to the demands of a national system of education. And in response to this, this particular curriculum framework came up. This has a core curriculum with science, social science, math, languages, and apart from that, as we have discussed, certain peripheral components. Now we see that for developing this curriculum, a number of activities were undertaken. For instance, teachers of rural schools were interviewed, principals of Kendriya Vidyalayas, public schools were interviewed, seminars were held at regional institutions of education. And this is how information was collected about the present curriculum and the about the ongoing curriculum and the changes that were required. So we see that while planning the curriculum, there are certain basic considerations which include the social forces, the nature of the learner, the nature of the discipline, and also the resources available at educational institutions, then the time available. And for this, it is necessary to collect information about the existing curricular provisions and then demarcate the areas that require further improvement or total change. Thank you.